Hi, this is Mark from SM Postcards again with another video on reselling postcards. Today, I have some news and current events. We'll go through the what sold. The special topic is patriotic postcards. What are they and what does that category include? And I have about three or four examples and some comps we're going to look at just to show you the wide range of prices for those types of cards. Then I have a special term today. It's called blind signature. And then I have some viewer comments at the end of the video, which gives you a little bit insights on how I do things and how I answer the questions. So if you're new here, don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss out on any information on how to help you learn to resell postcards online. So let's go ahead and get started. The news and the current events that I have, and I threw this topic, this part of the videos in because things do change. Now the videos are recorded a little early, so, and if you're watching this on a playback, it might be a little dated, but it does give you the current news if you haven't heard it. So the newest thing is the post office for their holiday pricing just raised their prices on packages and stuff like that. So you want to go out and check the eBay messages and stuff. Also, Australia has stopped all postage for 2 weeks due to what's going on in the world. So if you're shipping anything to Australia, you'll want to check to make sure that it's, you know, can be delivered. Also, on September 23rd, I think it's about 8 p.m. Eastern or 9 p.m. Eastern. I'll tell you a little bit more as I get closer. But on September 23rd, I'll be live on the Pittsburgh Picker channel. So right here is his little logo. So go check that out, get subscribed, and be ready for that night. If you got any questions, hit me up that night, and I'll try to answer them if I can. So let's go ahead and get started on what sold on eBay. I had no cards sell on Etsy or HIP. So some days, you know, I might sell 2 cards. And some days I might sell 20 cards or 30 cards. It's a roller coaster. So I look at the month. And also, this is the holiday weekend. Kids are back in school. I can make all the excuses like I can come up with, but it just for the month I'll do fine. And but I only had 15 cards on eBay and 0 on the other ones. So the first card that sold is one from the naval ship haul that I had, and this is an icebreaker, Navy icebreaker. It is a USS Staten Island AGB-5. Now, when I do these cards, if you can see the name, it has AG-5 on there. Some people might have saved searches because some boats I found were named, you know, 3 or 4 times, could be named USS Staten, and then the little AG-5 or the number at the end would differentiate what year that boat is. But this is a nice, solid ship card. And like I said in the last video, these naval ships are going to take me a long, long time to sell and a longer time to get my return on investment, but they're going to be here for a while and they're a consistent sale. But they kind of sell just like all the other cards. And that sold between $4 and $5. The next one is a lot of 7 cards this person bought. The first one, and they were all over the board of different things. This is the Apollo 11 moon landing. And right there is the capsule coming down. It's an unused card. It does have a little writing from an antique booth or flea market. I don't take those off. I leave it up to the collectors. But that's a neat little card. I bought a lot, and they had probably 100 or so Apollo cards in it. And that's where I got these cards. And I've done very well with them. And going through, they had good information on the back for the titles. Sold between $4 and $5. The next card is another card from the Naval Ship Hall. This is the Governor Island. This is the Coast Guard headquarters in Governor Island. I think it's in New York City. I've sold this card a couple times. I probably have about 200 of these cards. And that goes to the same person that bought the icebreaker in this 7-card lot. But it's a pretty cool picture, and it has Governor Island right on top. And it's a standard size card, 3.5 by 5.5. Sold between $4 and $5. I'll do one more card, and then I'll get into the special topic, patriotic cards. That's going to take a little bit, but I think it's pretty interesting because a lot of them see those. This card is the Regency Hyatt House in Atlanta, Georgia. It's a vertical card up and down this way. It's kind of a weird hotel. At first, I really didn't know what it was when I sold it or listed it. Unposted, chrome card, $4 to $5. So that person's lot was all over the place. So they were shopping in the store for a while, looking for stuff, and they got the volume discount. And they got 7 cards, so that would be 15% off. So we have volume discounts in our store. Because if you buy so many cards, you want to give the people... that's where you make a lot more money than selling a single card, is when you sell multiple cards and you can ship them in one envelope. So now, let's go ahead and get into the special topic for today. Patriotic postcards. I'll put it right down here what the definition is. I had to play with the definition a little bit because it was very broad on what a patriotic card is. You know, some people think the portraits of a president is patriotic. Some people, the American flag, you know, different things. So I kind of trimmed it down and I found a definition that kind of, I think, tells the story. So vintage patriotic postcards. They feature illustrations such as the American flag, the Lady Liberty, George Washington, bald eagles, Uncle Sam, and ladies and children dressed in red, white, and blue. And 4th of July cards also fit into this category. And you could probably put some other ones in there too. They kind of, you know, merge together with different other, you know, genres or categories. Now, there is another patriotic postcard that I won't get into this, and that's called Grand Army of the Republic, or GAR, or GAR. Those postcards are a special category that I wanted to do a video by itself. I have a little bit more research to do to understand a little bit more about the GAR. But they were an organization affiliated with, you know, politics and patriotic stuff. So, but I'll do another video in the future on just the Grand Army of the Republic GAR postcards. Now, these postcards, I found, as we're going to see here in a minute, the prices are just all over the board. I mean, you know, you really can't tie it down. You got to be very careful sometimes when you're pricing postcards, because you got over 9 million postcards on eBay, and you might find someone that sold it for $1 and $1 shipping, and you found someone else that sold it for $30 free shipping. You gotta kind of use your head and figure out that the guy that sold it for $1 shipping is a quantity auction seller, and the guy that sold it for $30 might just went to an impulse buyer. And so you gotta find that medium place that you want to put it in. You can price it anywhere you want. You can go to $1 shipping, or you can go to $30, $40. It just depends on what you want to do to the card and how much you got into it. I kind of go try to find a place that's going to sell and make me the most money, but also I don't want them to sit that long, etc., stuff like that. The sell-through rate on postcards is low. So doing a sell-through rate is how many you sold divided by your inventory every month. If I look at mine, it's 2 to 3%. What that means is out of every 100 cards that I have listed, I sell 3 cards. So if I sell 1,000 cards, that's 30 cards, or I have 1,000 listed. So if you have 100 cards listed, just statistically wise, just nothing scientific about that number, it could be 2 to 5 cards is the statistics that you'll sell. So quantity rules. Now the people that have really good cards, you know, high-end cards, that's a different sell-through rate. Those cards might sell faster for more money. So if you want to get into postcard selling, you can go to the low-end cards, the chromes, the linens, or you can go into the RPPCs and have less cards listed but more money. It's all over the board. So there's so many opportunities in reselling postcards. My model is quantity, lower-end cards. I sell as many cards as possible every month. And I have, right now, about 25,000 listings, individual listings on eBay, Etsy, and HIP. HIP and eBay are the same because they talk to each other. If I put it on eBay, it automatically goes to HIP. So I don't double count those. But the quantity I have is over 60,000 postcards, but I only have 25,000 listings. It's because I got multiples of cards with this naval ship haul that has brought my quantity so far up that it's just ridiculous. I never even thought about quantity before. I would have doubles, triples of a card, but I wouldn't have 300 of one card, 500 of one card. So quantity does rule. Does that mean I'm going to sell more since I got a lot of quantity? No, it just means I have the inventory. But 25,000 listings does very well for me. I didn't really see an increase in a nice flat line till I got about the 6,000 postcards listed, individual listings. That's when I really said, okay, I've made it. Now I can, I got a nice cash flow coming in. I'm selling enough cards to pay the bills and to buy some more, postcards. So a little rant there, but let me get back to the subject. So we'll get into the pricing here in a minute, but the sky's the limit on these cards, and the bottom can be very cheap. So we'll get into that. So the cards that I have to show you that I have in my collection, I went to an auction maybe 2-3 years ago, and they had a lot of George Washington postcards, Thanksgiving emboss cards from a nice collection and books. I paid up on them, but you know what? I haven't sold that many of them. So I have it on my list this month to take a look at those cards and see if I got them priced too high. Maybe I can throw a sale on them and try to get my money back, because it's probably a bad buy. I paid up on them and stuff. But the first one I got is Father, I Cannot Tell a Lie. I did it and with my little hatchet. This is George Washington cutting down the cherry tree on there. Nice vertical card. It was posted in 1910. It's embossed. I don't know if you can see that, but embossing means it's got a raised relief on the outside. But it's got a nice, it's Dover, New Hampshire cancel on there. It's got a 1-cent stamp. But that's a real nice George Washington card, but it hasn't sold in 3 years. I think my price is too high. The next one I got out of that lot was a pretty cool card, I thought, as well. When I looked through these albums, these were all in nice postcard albums, the whole works, but just didn't go. So this is George Washington with his favorite horse. There's the cherry tree, and this is an embossed card. All these cards are embossed, and this is another vertical card, but that's a really nice card. But people just aren't in the George Washington. So I got to figure out why these haven't moved. I've kind of kept putting it to the side every month. And I keep making a mess here. And the last one out of my collection, I only grabbed 3 of them, but I probably have 150 of different cards from those auctions on Abe Lincoln, George Washington. There are some Thanksgiving ones in there. There were some 4th of July. But these are the ones. So this one is Washington, his boyhood days. Young George Washington with the cherry tree. This is embossed on there. I don't know if you can see that. But that's another nice card. 1913 this was posted. These were very well kept in those albums. There's no mark, no album marks on there. The edges are, fine. And this one has Fenway Station. It actually has a cancel on there for a station. Says Fenway Station. And I do the front and back in the scanner. This one still didn't sell. And I think I got these cards like $8 to $12. So I can go down a little bit lower and still meet my margin. But I don't know if it's all price or it's just something that people don't look for. So I got to do some research and see what's sold out there and spend some time on that. Do some maintenance in my store. Clean up my mess. Now let's take a look over here. I went out on eBay and I pulled up some cards. I sorted it by the highest. So this is one of the highest postcards, priced postcards I found. $85 in free shipping for a rare vintage Labor Day postcard worker. Flag, Eagle, Hammers, Wheel. So this person, if you look at that title, a lot of keywords in there, but it doesn't read English. I just read it to you and it sounded like I was speaking foreign. Rare, vintage, Labor Day, postcard, worker, flag, eagle, hammer, wheel. I've seen that a lot. It works. Do what you think works. Me, I use a little bit more English because I export postcards to some other sites. And it shows in the title. Plus, I've been very successful in the way I've been doing it. But you'll see this out there. And remember, titles are not what they're going to... They're going to look at the picture. They buy by sight. Just like they eat food, they eat it by sight. But $85 for this card, what makes it different than this? It's a flag with a worker. This is George with a hatchet. So they say rare. I don't really look at rare. I never search on rare because everything's rare, as people think. But that's $85. So that was the top end. The next one, we're working down in the price here. The next one I found is a couple kids, circa 1909, 4th of July, Lady Liberty, firecrackers, embossed vintage postcard, rare. It's probably the same seller, the way they did the title, but $34.50 for that. That's a good sell on there. Then the next one, as we go down, this is the 4th of July. July 4th, here we are again, is what the title is. Vintage patriotic postcard, pantless child rides a rocket. That title I'd be a little careful with. But $20, they got $20 for that card. The next one, the lowest one I found, was George Washington on a horse, $2.90, plus some shipping, maybe a dollar or something, I can't really read it on my screen. So you went from $85 to $2.90. So where would you price this card? It's not the top one with the guy with the worker, $85, but it's down in the $2.90 with George. So is the problem George? But a kid on a firecracker sold for $20, and I can't get $8 for this. So that's the dilemma with postcards. And I wanted to show you the price range when you're doing comps and stuff out there. But these are really good cards. I list them all the time. I don't wait till the holidays. I list everything. Whenever I list Christmas in August or February, Halloween and stuff, you know, just list it. And that way it's already out there in the search engines and stuff like that. But those are the patriotic cards. So you want to be careful with them. You want to do your homework before you buy them. So you don't go out and spend a ton of money on 150, 200 cards and they just sit. It will happen. You know, I don't know everything, but what I thought hasn't panned out, so I need to make a change. I need to find out why these 150 cards haven't sold. Will I figure it out? I'll give it a shot. But that's patriotic cards. Watch for them, look for them, check your prices. Who knew? Okay, now I'm going to get into the terminology, the definition for today. It's called blind signature. Now, if you hear like a cricket in the background, I had a cricket get in my fish room, and he's back behind the fish tanks, and he's been driving me nuts for 3 days. So if I can get a hold of him, he'll be fish food soon. So that's what that noise is. So blind signature. This is kind of different when I was reading this term. What is a blind signature? It is the name of the photographer or publisher of a postcard that is embossed into its surface rather than being printed onto it. It can be applied with a metal stamp, you know, by taking a postcard and just stamping it with there, no ink or anything. Blind signatures were most often used by photographers as a way of eliminating any need for placing printing on a card, thus lowering costs by keeping all the production in the studio. So they didn't have to send it out to get printed, so they could use a blind signature just by embossing their name into it and didn't need all the ink and stuff, just a stamp. They can be found on the card's border, within the image area, and also read through the front side. Sometimes titles were also added onto cards in this manner. Maybe you've seen some postcards that has like a little embossed name on it. It's kind of raised, the lettering, and it just kind of pushes through. There's no ink. Those are blind signatures. They do not include the use of ink or foil. So foil sometimes, you know, are on those types of embossing, but it just presses through the cards. It's just a way to impress on the card and put a little relief on it. They're also sometimes called blind embossed. So if you ever see a postcard and it has an artist's signature or a photographer pushed in there, you know it's a blind signature. Would I put that in a title and say it's got a blind signature? I never have. I tried to go out and see if I had any examples in my collection, and I didn't find any that were clear enough to what this definition is, and I looked online and it was kind of hard. So take a look and see if you see any of those cards that has a blind signature. But that's the term for today, blind signature. Who knew? Let me go ahead and finish up the eBay what sold. We only got a couple cards left here. Remember, I only sold 15 cards. So the next one that was still in that, this is the last one of, I think, the ladies or the guys' seven-card haul. This is Governor Winter arrives at Salem in Arbrella. Today's a drop day. This is the vertical card of Pilgrims. I do pretty well with Plymouth stuff. The Plymouth Rock I've sold many times, the Mayflower replicas, the ships, the Pina and the Nina and the Mayflower. So when I look in lots and stuff, I do look for Pilgrims. If I can get them for a pretty cheap price. I'm also going to show you today, I went to the antique mall yesterday. We got out, and remember, I go to antique malls and I pay up on postcards. I look through all the boxes, and I haven't been there in a while, and I did find some cards. I found 28 cards. One card paid for them all, and I'll show you what that is here after I get done with this. The next one is just a view card. It's a road with autumn trees approaching Skyline Drive on U.S. Highway 211 from Sperryville, Virginia. It's in Shenandoah National Park, Virginia. It's a road with autumn trees. Most people wouldn't list that card. I got $4 to $5 for it. Unposted, lighter cardstock. Looks good. People are using it for crafting or they live by there. The next one is the U.S. Capitol, an airplane view of the library in the U.S. Capitol on there. Nice air view. Now this is a white border card. It's a 1 cent. It's not real glisteny. I can just feel it that it's vintage on that cardstock. Unposted, 1 cent stamp box. That's a white border card of the U.S. Capitol, $4 to $5. Next card, I've sold this card many, many, many times. The little church around the corner, New York City. There it is right there. You want to make sure you get Little Church Around the Corner in your title. People search on that. This is a linen card, and it does have the flea market thing I take off. It's unposted. So this person, I've sold a lot of unposted cards today, but that's the Little Church Around the Corner. When I see those in the cards, I know I can sell those for $4 to $5. The next one is a white border card. South Court, Kenton, Hamilton Halls, Columbia University. Universities, I'm telling you. Just like Puerto Rico and Caribbean Islands, if you find anything with a university, make sure you get it in the title. This is a white border card, 1933, of Hamilton, the halls at the Columbia University in New York City. Nice card. And it is posted in 1933. $4 to $5. Universities sell. Find those cards. The next one. There's two things with this. I got a little extra money. This sold between $5 and $6. And Big Hoss. This is a Continental card. Couple things going on with this card. This guy here, he passed away in surgery, after a surgery or something. He died young. But Big Hoss Ponderosa sells. This also has, you can see on the top there, what they call a scalloped edge. And this is a Continental card. From my other video, it's a 6x4 card. I do not sell that many Continentals. They usually go in the flea market box, or I just can't get them to go. But Big Hoss had to go on. And right here it says Ponderosa Ranch, Incline Village, Nevada. So it's kind of a studio card. But that was a great picture. I had to put him up. I don't know where Little Joe is, but he sold. The next one is some kind of point in San Pedro, California. Kind of a weird card. It's a kind of a hand-painted card. But I'm saving my red and bright cards right now. I'm putting them in a pile when I see them. And I'm going to list them all at once. I'm going to list like maybe 50 of the red. I'm finding anything that's really bright, like lava, big sunsets, big yellow boats. They seem to sell a little quicker, so I might have a theory here I'm working on. I have to get my foil hat out. But for some reason, this bright red, this sold. This is just a cliff drawing, and it sold $4 to $5. And this is an undivided back or divided back card on there, middle of the period, $4 to $5. The next one is one of these businessman July expense account. I've sold many of these cards. They're kind of in the comic novelty thing, but it kind of shows a list of things and a little comic. It's on that comic card stock that's real thick. And so that sold $4 to $5. Remember with the comic cards, a lot of people think they'll sell. What people do is they go in and read them, get a giggle, and move on. I do sell them, but not as much as I thought they would when I got in, you know, putting them online. A lot of people just read them. So be careful with those. But you want to get a few up there for variety and stuff like that, but I wouldn't actively search for those. You'll get them in lots and stuff like that, pretty cheap. The next one is Water Company Dam on Lake Vermilion, Danville, Illinois. That's about 2-3 hours south of me. Nice picture of a dam, white border card. It was posted 1956. But that's a really nice card there. $4 to $5. Dams do pretty good. The next card, these two, they're like Pueblo. This was Crystal Ray Christ the King Church, Santa Fe, New Mexico. That's a chrome card of Crystal Key, $4 to $5. And the last card that I will show today for eBay is the same church, different view. And this one's a linen card. So if you look at the two, the top one is the chrome card, and the bottom is the linen card. And you can tell a little difference with the details. There's some grass and stuff on the chrome, some clouds, but they don't have that. There's your blue for your linen. See how it's kind of a little more vibrant on the linens. And then there's no grass and stuff. So some of this stuff was airbrush, as I said with the definition. But that person bought both of these. So they did a search, or a safe search, for the Crystal Ray Christ the King Church in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And both of those sold. So I got basically $8, $9 for two cards. So all those 15 cards, that was about $70 in sales. They'll go out in the mail the next day. But it wasn't a bad day, but I just didn't sell anything on Etsy or HIP. But it'll go up and down and come back. But we did go to the antique store yesterday, and we bought some cards, and I'll kind of go through what I did. I looked through 2-3 boxes over there, about a half hour, and I paid basically 25 cents for each one of these cards. Remember, you're going to pay up when you go to antique malls, so you just got to adjust it with the prices. But this was the Blue Haven Motel cell. This one is Clearwater Beach, Florida, you know, beach cells. I like the way it looked. It was unposted. Daytona Beach is always good. Nighttime view. This is Richmond County. This was a college. Knew it right away when I saw it. So another university. There's a sign. Motel and a sign. That'll sell. This one I picked up. They had a lot of these, but I only picked one of them up. The Wagon Wheel in Rockton, Illinois. I'm in Illinois, that's why I always try to pick up Illinois cards. So I picked that. It's a linen card. It does have some kid drew on the back. No big deal. So that's a linen card. This one, some guy. This says, "Here rest Clubfoot George, hung by mistake." Some lady crying at a grave. It must be a ghost town thing or something. Mourners at Boot. Oh, it's Boot Hill in Knott's Berry Farm, Ghost Town, California. Knott's Berry Farm does pretty well. Here's another Wagon Wheel inside. That's one of the cards that's kind of bright, if you notice. So that's going to go in my pile for the red and the bright card test. This was that cypress tree. This is the Lone Cypress on Midway Point in Pebble Beach, California. I've sold this card so many times whenever I see that little cypress tree. I actually drove by there. I ran service over in that area. But that's that little tree. And you'll see a few of these. Seal Rock, same, you know, out there in Santa Cruz. Those are nice things to see. Casa Rio Mexican Food, some kind of restaurant, but it's got a sign. And this was really a nice one. This was just a Bel Air Hotel, nice mosaic with different pictures of the motel. I kind of like this one because the color, it's a linen card, and just the way it's mixed, it's going to look good in the store and presentation. This is the card. I want to save this card. This card right here, I'm going to save. That's the one that paid for all 28 of these cards. I paid $7 or something for all these cards. This is an air view of a village, Rock Springs, Wyoming. Those always do well. Swimming pools. And people always do well. Islanders Inn in Hawaii. Hawaii card. Cove Haven. Autumn. I thought it was pretty cool. Kind of dated. Kind of retro. Remember, I only paid 25 cents for these cards. There's Motor Inn. There's a sign. Another motel. This is Wisconsin Dells. I bought it because the lady standing next to what they call the beehive. Kind of dated with her dress and stuff. Does pretty good. This is some kind of logs. Lumberman's Arch, Stanley Park, Vancouver, Canada. Anything with redwoods or stuff like that. Paul Bunyan. Do pretty well. This is a Canada card. I saw it there. Now, this was a weird card. I had to take a look at this one. It stopped me in my tracks. What is this? What do you think that is? Yeah, it's a warehouse. It's an ice skating rink. Wagon Wheel Lodge, Rockton, Illinois. It's a Palace ice skating rink. I thought it was a pretty cool card. This is the Causeway in Clearwater, Florida. So it's got an older car in it right up here. So that's why I picked that up. It's probably changed a lot. This is some cottage. This is not a RPPC. This is a chrome card, but it's a cottage. So maybe someone stayed there. Another lake scene, boats. So always got to pick those up. This is a scout reservation in Michigan. Cypress tree, Pebble Beach. Train, California train. Some kind of assembly. Place had a nice sign up there. There's the cypress tree again, same card. So 28 cards, 25 cents a piece. Disney Adventureland Natives, Disneyland, right there. This is an $8 to $12 card. I paid $7 for all these cards yesterday, and this one card paid for my whole lot. So you always want to find Disney. In the Adventureland, I think they changed a lot of that now, too. So those cards are going to get rarer. But when you go to antique malls and stuff, you want to, you know, just look through the boxes, pick them out. Right there. You know, 28. It's about $125, $150 in sales. Paid $7 for it. And now I'm going to get into the viewer comments. This is a special section for me. I like these because it kind of lets me improv a little bit. Let you know stuff, and people really like them. So the first comment I got is, "This video is great. Thank you. I was wondering if you have any experience with panorama cards. This just came in the other day. They are longer cards, but of hotels, motels across Canada and U.S. of the 60s, 1960s and 80s. I don't do a lot with these types of cards. This is, I think, what they're talking about is the longer card. That's a 3.5, is a longer card, and they would have a panoramic. Now, this one is of one of the boats, and it's showing shooting a missile off in the boat, but usually a panoramic card. I don't actively search for those, I told her. I don't really know the prices. They usually go in the flea market box. This is 9 inches. It doesn't fit in my envelope. So I'd have to get another envelope. I'd have to probably charge shipping for that, stuff like that. And are these cards worth, you know, $9, $10, $12 with the shipping and everything? That's probably why I don't get to do them. So, but panoramic cards, the larger jumbo, watch our video on the jumbo cards. I don't do a lot with those. So I really couldn't respond to her with any experience on those at all, except what I do. Now the next one, Russell is always on me. About the way I announce towns. I destroy names. So if I insult anyone, I apologize now. But Russell came back again after I said this one. You are pronouncing Rehoboth. It's R-E-H-O-B-O-T-H. Wrong. It's pronounced Rehoboth, not Rehoboth. So I apologize if I destroy any names. But I did get the Henry Ford Museum correct, he said. At least I got one out of three that day. Next question I got. Mark, thanks for great videos. How do you track your financial information for selling online? Now, I don't do, you know, recommend taxes and all that stuff on this video, but I can tell you the basics, what I do. So I am a licensed business in two states, Illinois and Indiana. I do pay sales tax. That's outside of eBay, Etsy, or whatever they collect for it in both of those states. I do have a business insurance that covers, you know, all the legalities and stuff like that. I pay it once a year for my inventory or whatever. They won't give you the money that what your speculative sales are, but I would be able to replace what I paid for these cards in my other inventory. So I keep track of that on a spreadsheet. I have Etsy, Hip, and eBay to track. So this is what these videos are about. So for eBay, I use Easy Auction Tracker, and I have an affiliate link at the bottom. I think I get $5 off my yearly subscription. It costs like $55 a year or something, like $49.95. And it's a Excel spreadsheet, and the requirements and everything are on that site. But what it does, when I sell something on eBay, this actually goes out and gets all the fees and everything like that, and gives you a nice breakdown by month, by year, the whole works. And you can I put my inventory into the inventory tab. So every postcard is in that spreadsheet with a SKU number. So when it sells, it automatically puts my cost of goods sold in there, the whole works. I take that number from my toy store and my postcard store, and I transfer it to a main spreadsheet that I use that I put everything on. So Easy Auction Tracker will make your life easier for tracking fees. Because what I like about it, say eBay changes the fees, I don't have to do anything. Easy Auction Tracker just reads what comes from eBay and puts it in a nice spreadsheet for you. Now, you do have to massage a few things once in a while on there and stuff like that, but not too often. You got the tracking number in there, you got the SKU number and date it sold, what state it went to. Anything that eBay sends over, Josh, Easy Auction Tracker will read. They have a sample one, example one that you can download and run it. It does like every other month or 3 months. And it can only go back 3 months because that's all eBay keeps. So if you want to do it and you like it, you got to get it, you know, before like March, end of March, so you can get the whole year in there. For Etsy doesn't have an Easy Auction Tracker, so I bought GoDaddy Bookkeeping, and that talks to my Etsy postcard store. And that grabs the sales and the expenses, and so all I have to put in there is my shipping, you know, for stamp, and the cost of goods sold, and it gives me a nice P&L statement. And I transfer that number to my spreadsheet. So I have two applications that I grab the data from, Etsy and there. And I do have a video on, I think it's called Cleaning Up My Mess from Financial Data, because I created a monster. And I also have another way of tracking my keeping my money organized as well. I have four different accounts. One's operating expense that everything's paid to, eBay, PayPal, everybody's connected to. I have another one for my inventory. Have one that I keep taxes and long-term bills, like insurance I pay once a year. I put money into that every month, so when that comes up, I don't have to write that big, you know, come up with the money from other things. And then at the bottom is a surplus, but I only have one account that everybody's connected to. The other three accounts, only me and the bank have access to. And I can do all that online and transfer money around. So you might want to watch those videos. They're pretty quick. But that's how I track financial information. Every month, for every quarter, like January, February, March, I keep my receipts and I keep the data up to date, nice and tidy. And then once a quarter, I go through and I true everything up. I do it for real, you know, I spend 3 or 4 hours that day to true everything up for the quarter. And then I put those numbers onto my tax sheet on my spreadsheet. And I give my accountant at the end of the year about 15 numbers and some explanations on a few things. But I don't have to race around at the end of the year. My stuff's ready to go, you know, on there. But I do pay quarterly income tax, send a check to IRS 4 times a year. And you might want to look into that. There's some changes coming up in 2022 where people will get 1099s before they didn't. I don't have a problem with that because I've been I I already pay that. I think the self-employment tax is 20-25%. I have a little calculation, and me and the accountant figured out my estimated sales. We broke it down in four payments, and I just send them in to her. I try to get them in there right now early because the slowdown on doing manual on there, and I, for some reason, cannot get online yet. We've been trying this year to get signed up online so I can just pay it right there, but they don't know who you are. You can't talk to anybody and stuff, so we just send the payment vouchers in right now. But that's how I track financial information. I don't spend a lot of time on it, but you need to know your numbers. You need to know how many cards you're selling. Are you making profit on them? So you can make, what that does is it gives you an idea to make decisions. Don't make a decision on what you feel. Make decisions on the data that you see. So if I see my margins going down, did my postage go up? Did my cost of goods sold go up? What happened? I can look real quick and make a decision. So make an educated decision. Some decision you make, you just do it. But financial information is just another indicator of how you're doing. Just like feedback. You don't want to base your whole business on feedback. That's another person's opinion. But you take all those together, it will tell you the health of your store. So that's hopefully probably a long answer on that. But if you got any more questions about that, just let me know on there. As long as they're not totally tax related or what to use. I'm not. That's why I have an accountant. Next one I have, and the last viewer comment was, what days of the week do you ship in mail? So I've had a lot of people ask me that. They only ship, you know, three times a week, once a week, and stuff like that. To me, the sellers nowadays think they have a sense of entitlement. I'm a business. I'm going to ship when I want to. Now, some people can't ship because they're just not able to. There's other reasons. They're working two jobs, or they got a lot of, you know, kid problems or medical. That's fine. But majority of people, I ship one day business. So every morning, I ship every morning. And so Monday through Saturday, excluding holidays. But every morning, all my stuff goes out. And by the time I walk to the mailbox, if it hasn't sold by the time I go to the mailbox, it goes to next day. I don't, every time I sell something, I don't rush in and ship it out. What I found in postcards, I do not have immediate payment turned on. I have non-immediate payment turned on. People will go in and buy a card. So say Lewis went in there and bought two cards. I'm going to hurry and pack and get in the mailbox, get them out, you know, in an hour. No, I found out I don't do that. I let them soak till the next day. Because Lewis might go in that night and find two more cards. I have so many people that do that. And I can ship them together, save on shipping, make a little more money. And plus, they get all their cards at once. So postcards I do once a day. Now, coming up with the holidays, I'll probably end up watching that a little closer. If we have a real big slowdown, definitely they're going out in the morning. And I might make a run to the blue box in the afternoon with any cards just to get that extra day if we have a slowdown like we did last year. I did that last year where I ran, you know, if I have some cards and stuff, I'll run them over there. But normally, I ship out once a day. I do first class. I ship with eBay standard envelope for postcards, first class for priority. And with my toy store, I use first class and priority. I do not do expedited shipping. No way. I did that once. I'm not going to jump through those hoops. It's not guaranteed. I have people want it and stuff like that. They need to go find another seller. I don't use UPS. I don't use FedEx. I'm straight post office because all my items are smaller. And I do ship international, 4 pounds or less, direct in packages. Anything over that goes to GSP, a global shipping program, and stuff like that. So I'm kind of strict on the things. I don't want to run it over to UPS store, FedEx, find a box, pay the shipping, get billed at the end of the month. I don't do all that. So, but once a day, next business day, get those cards out. There's over 9 million cards on eBay. Those sellers are shipping out the next day. So make sure you check this video out here on I Fixed My Mess for tracking financial data if you have any questions about that. But I do have the video up there and the one about the checking accounts. It might help you, it might not. But I thought I'd throw them up there. I got a lot of questions. That's all I got for today. Thanks for watching. And we'll catch you.